him this morning, we have a puppy, and he wakes me up to go outside, and I just kind of blindly walk him until he does everything he needs to do, and then we come back in, and then I'm watering the plants. I'm thinking about, what does God want? And so, I don't know about you, but I find that, you know, people talk about meditating, I find cleaning kind of meditating. So I'm mopping the floor of my studio. It's kind of big, so it takes a while. And the phone rings, and it's Claudia. She wants to know, where are you? And I'm like, I'm home. And she's like, well, you're supposed to be digging me up. And I realized that things have a way of completely leaving my body, my mind. And as I am rushing to pull myself together and think about what I want to talk about, I'm thinking about why is that? And I'm like, I'm really full. Anybody in here full? I'm really full. Since last year, when I was here, I turned 60, so that's a major milestone for me. And I think last time we were here together, I think most of you recognize, we talked about the secret: ask, believe, receive. And so I am quite verbose with God. I talk all the time. And I received a lot of what I asked for. And what's interesting about my, let's talk about my projects. What's interesting about my project is I compete for a living, so I always have to come up with the winning idea. And usually the public art projects that I go after them because they're meaningful. I believe that they're going to be meaningful to the community. I believe they're going to be meaningful in a worldly way if someone actually comes from some other part of the world and sees them. So my constant question, what I'm asking is, what matters? What matters the most? And in the last year or so, one of the recurring issues is one of civility. So, for instance, in Boston, the gentleman who founded kayak.com, I'm sure you've heard of it, maybe not used it, but kayak.com is kind of like Expedia, many of them travel awfully. He is a software engineer and he goes to San Francisco all the time because that part of the world is like not just software engineers. And he loves the Martin Luther King Memorial in San Francisco. And he decided that he wanted to create that kind of energy in Boston. So he put $1 million and he started what he wants to be a $5 million public art installation that acknowledges, of course, Martin Luther King, as well as Coretta Scott King. And so I went up to Boston to listen to the community and try to understand what matters to them. And I found it interesting that most people forget that Coretta was an artist. She was a singer and musician, and she was in Boston for music. She was going to the music conservatory there. And again, this is at the beginning of their lives. You know, they're brand new in college, and they're young, and they're beautiful, and they have dreams. And they talked about the beloved community, and I had never heard this. You know, I mean, Martin Luther King, it's been 50 some odd years for me, and I had never heard of this concept of the beloved community. And so, again, you know, when I come out of the box, I like to be very knowledgeable and well-versed, because I want to act like I know what I'm talking about. And so I had to seriously research. And so, you know, he had this vision. You know, this is a man who defined civility. This is how we should be. And of course, because he was, you know, a man of the cloth and he came from a family like this, you know, he was very much grounded in scripture and religion and God. And so I'm in the process of expecting, I expect to at least become a finalist. And so I'm trying to figure out what matters, again, in the concept of civility. This is the 15th anniversary of Martin Luther King's assassination. So there are six public articles for Martin Luther King. The other five are in Atlanta. And I think it's very interesting. I went to this King Center last month. Probably my first time going into downtown Atlanta. I went on a Saturday. I had originally tried to go over a week, but flight kept getting canceled because of the bad weather. And so I get here on a Saturday, and it's like a ghost town. Except that there are these groups of people wandering, and at some point I realized these are homeless people. I mean, not to be derogatory, it was like being in a movie, like Walking Dead or something. And it was very sad. And so I'm thinking, because I'm coming from Westchester County, I'm thinking, so what is this? You know, I'm with my cousin who lives there, I'm like, what is this? I'm trying to understand, what is this that I'm seeing? I kind of see it, but I'm not really processing it well because it doesn't make really good sense to me. And so he says, well, you know, the last mayor sold the shelter and didn't make provisions for them, so it's every man for himself. I'm like, that's not so wise. And so I think it's interesting that the new mayor, she's a woman, has created five commissions, and she has a vision. She wants a monument. She wants a civil rights law that's going to allow the community to decide which members of the civil rights movement merit being on this walk. They're going to have benches where people sit and contemplate civil rights versus human rights. And so they want a fountain, million dollar fountain. And so I think it's a good thing because it will be hopefully inspiring and educational to, again, whoever comes to Atlanta. Mind you, they're getting ready for the Olympics because that's the next site. And so the question is, how do you prioritize civility? You know, you can't do everything. I mean, and I'm just going to use the Atlanta thing as an example. It's like, okay, you could do a lot with $2 million, but you know, there's the big vision, and then there's the one right in front of you, and you have to kind of decide where's the happy medium. It's a difficult decision. But I think in the final analysis, and mind you, this is a hot discussion in the public art world, because we're all trying to figure out what kind of value we bring to the arena. Our job is to beautify, of course, but it's also to inform. And so, you know, again, whenever a public art project comes to perform, I think I can win. I'm always looking, again, what does God want me to say? Because ultimately, that's part of the point of art. Art is also healing. It helps to heal souls. So, for instance, I'm working on a sculpture in Hartford, Connecticut. And it's interesting, I didn't know that Hartford had a very, really large African American community until I got this commission. And I'm up there trying to introduce myself to the community. And I'm having a very unusual experience. And I'm trying to understand, what is this? Again, you know, I have my experience. I'm sure you guys are the same way. Even if you have an unusual experience, you need to figure out, like, in the context of the rest of my world, what is this that I'm experiencing now? And so I'm at a cocktail party, and I'm talking to the city councilman, and I'm trying to convey my experience, and he stops me and he says, you're talking about a community of 80,000 where only 5,000 voted last election. I was like, what? He's like, yeah, 5,000 out of 80,000. And that said to me, that's a lot to me. It's like these people don't have enough hope to go to the ballot box to make a decision. They're just like, whatever. And that's kind of like, it's kind of like driving your car and closing your eyes and thinking that's going to happen before you stop. And so the sculpture that I am making is Walter Doc Perlin, who was an educator in the 50s, 60s. And he wanted very badly, he was a superstar in athletics, 6'5", great basketball, great football. You know, he was all-star, lettered, you know, his college at Virginia State. And what he really wanted to do was coach, and they wouldn't let him because he was black. So he became an administrator, ultimately, you know, in the Hartford schools. But he decided to do something to make life better for the youth. So he decided to just raise hundreds of thousands of dollars and send kids to college, more than 200 kids to college, full boat. You mentioned his name in Hartford, and I mean, he's the most beloved man. I mean, beloved. And so, what's interesting about the sculpture is that it is the first sculpture of a contemporary African American in the state of Connecticut, ever. And there was quite a bit of a flurry, frankly, from the white community, because they wanted to know, why him? You know, why not Mary Anderson or somebody? And of course, the senator, who originally was state rep, said, why not him? He's an educator. What better person to highlight than someone who exalts education? I mean, yeah, Mary Anderson was all that, but this is an everyday man, just a regular everyday guy who decided to do something to make life really more civilized for black youth coming up. So hopefully maybe they can have their dreams come true. Marvin Gaye. I'm doing Marvin Gaye. Oh man. When I heard that Marvin Gaye was coming to the commission, I was like, give it to me, it's mine. And they're like, oh, we want to give it to you. And I'm like, ooh. And so I had to compete. And it's interesting how you have to make decisions about doing the right thing. You know, you come to a point and your decision is going to make a difference, win or lose. And you have to figure out what's the best thing to say, what's the right thing to say. And of course I grew up with Marvin Gaye. You know, live Marvin Gaye on the TV. He's on the TV, I call people, you know, in the old days. He's on the TV, channel 2. I remember being a teenager watching him and with our friends and saying, oh, he's high. Oh. It was one of those things where it was amazing because that made him human like the rest of us, but it was sad because he was out of control. But he was a genius. He really was. And so I'm researching him, and I'm trying to figure out what's the best part of Marvin Gaye that I should exalt. And it turned out to be the What's Going On album and the What's Going On story. You know, of course, I'm sure you guys know the What's Going On song and What's Going On album, if not the whole thing. You've heard some part of it. But what makes that album really, really remarkable is that Marvin Gaye's brother was in Vietnam fighting the Vietnam War, and he's writing Marvin letters about death. We got police brutality and whatnot going on at Kent State. And they arrested Angela Davis, and I mean, all this stuff is on the news, and we're all wondering, what is going on? It was like the whole world was like, what's going on? This is just, it's crazy. And so Marvin wrote this anthem. And then he decided he was going to create this long-playing album, which was going to be a story. Like, one song was going to roll into the next, and really, it's like one story after another after another. And I like that idea on storytelling. But I do, I'm doing that now, stories. But what made it interesting was that Marvin's, again, his words were, you know, there's this part to me of you dying. You know, he's going on about, you know, what's going on. And so, of course, people related to it. And he went from being a two-dimensional sex symbol to being a three-dimensional man who had concerns like the rest of us, because in those days, almost everybody knew somebody who had died and needed it no more. You know, I think the last major war we had, we lost 6,000 people in the whole war. They were losing 6,000 people every 6 months. It's like the numbers were just off the chart. And half of us don't even know what that war was about. It wasn't even really a war. But the point of it is that the stanza, war is not the answer, only love can conquer hate, is what I emblazed on his pedestal. Growing in a DC neighborhood that is white. I went to the community meeting when we were competing, actually, and meeting started at 7. We didn't get to speak till like 9:30. People were irritable and tired because they were talking about drug addicts shooting up in the kids' park and people dumping in the middle. They had real issues. And while they appreciated getting public art, they weren't really thrilled about Marvin Gaye because Marvin Gaye didn't do anything specifically for that neighborhood. He didn't come back to D.C. And I thought about that, and of course, you know, these are older black people that feel entitled to say whatever they want. They were very blunt with us. And, you know, I had to say to them, I appreciate your point, but, you know, he was working more on a global level, trying to explain to people why war is not the answer. You know, and he thought about it, you know. Barry Gordy didn't want to produce that album. You know, why don't you just sing another love song? And Marvin's like, I'm not singing another song until you produce this. And they were fighting about it. And luckily, one of the engineers helped them get it done. And then they leaked it on the radio. Sounds like Beyonce. Leaked it on the radio, and of course, it took off. It's a great story. And again, I think it's one that's worth remembering because it's interesting, you know, every now and then, I know you guys peruse Facebook, you know, you get this random news on Facebook, you have good friends, and people don't like Facebook. It's like, well, you have to learn how to pick friends, because you do get to choose on there. If you don't like somebody, you can block them. But that doesn't work anymore. You know, it's not in real life. But the point of it is that you get these random news postings, and you hear about places where you have gang violence. You know, Hartford has a gang problem. There's a lot of places in civilized North America, United States of America, where we have gang problems. And of course, here in Westchester, now we have a heroin problem. You know, nobody was really caring before. You know, but now we've got like the larger population. It's a concern. And so the point of it again is to try to figure out how to turn it around, how to make a difference. You know, it's one thing to spout your opinion, it's another thing to do something. And so, for me, I think that the strongest thing is to use the voice that I have. I'm an artist. I use my artist's voice. What's interesting now is that now people actually want to know what I want to say. Some radio station from Arizona had me on the radio yesterday for the second time, because, you know, we're talking about what can artists do? You know, what can the average person do? Pick whatever thing you want to fix. You know, you want to fix the hungry? The homeless? it, you know, it could be something really just in your neighborhood to make things nicer, civilized. People are mostly in survival mode. I know I am. The reason why I couldn't remember that I was supposed to be here today, I am competing for a dozen things all at once. And I'm looking for more stuff. So my mind at this point is very myopic because I'm trying to figure out, again, what does God want me to do? What am I supposed to be doing? You know, when I'm done, I want to be satisfied. I want to be not afraid to die. Like, oh no, I'm ready. Come on. Because I did my best. Agreement number four. And so I say this all to say that, you know, it's important to figure out what to do with yourself. You know, life is not random. Nobody's random. You guys remember my story from last year? It's my favorite story. Talking about purpose and random. I grows up in a family where his father beats him and his mother is an alcoholic. And he drops out of school early. And he just starts to waste his life. And people walk by him and they think he's wasting his life. And one morning he sees a little boy step off the curb and he snatches him back just in time to keep him from being hit by a car. And the little boy grows up to be Martin Luther King. That's why that man is not random. So you never know what you say to someone. What you do for someone. You never know when that thing is the thing that really helps that person become what God wants them to be. Sometimes it's very small. You know, you've got people who do big things. And my sister has a woman and three little kids living in her house right now. And it's a long story, but sister has eight kids of her own. It's just like, not only half her kids are grown, but the point of it is my sister takes people in. That's her thing. You know, you need a home, she takes people in. She's got eight kids, five of them are adopted. And I remember asking me, do you think I'm crazy? And I was like, no, but you're gonna need some help. And, you know, now, again, because almost all her children, one of her youngest children, are going to college next year. So she's pretty much done raising kids unless she takes on the new ones, and that's what she's doing now. But the point of it is that at the beginning, it looked really daunting, but amazingly, people helped her. And I'm sure when you think about it, when you think about where you are in your life, people have helped you too. And so I like that idiom, each one teach one, you know, reach back and help someone, pay it forward, all of that. That to me is how we're going to regain civility. We can't just let it go. We can't let it go. I don't want to get into politics. That's not really the point. The point is, we're having a great illustration. You know how they said the pendulum swings both ways? We're having a great illustration now of what it looks like when the pendulum swings all the way to the left. Sooner or later, it's going to come back to the center and it's going to swing again to the right. And the question is, which side of the pendulum are you perpetuating? What matters to you? Because in the end, we have each other. And if we're going to be okay, we're going to have to figure out how to be more civilized. And again, for those of you that sing, again, you know, that artistry heals people. If I'm going to relax myself and make art, I put on music. And then I have all kinds of music. You know, every now and then I get in a group, I want to hear opera. I'll listen to a bunch of things, you know, because I find that it helps to reset my energy. You know, everybody can exalt something that they love to an art. That's what art is. It's really about love and passion about something. It could be a cupcake maker and exalt it to an art. Again, sometimes just that process helps somebody be better. So I'm going to sum it up. I'm hoping that in the future you will find something that matters to you, that you will expend a little bit of your time, a little bit of your energy, if you got it, money is nice too. Help somebody. Do something good to make the world a nicer place. Thank you.